Yes, indeedy. Welcome back, world.
You've entered the Shadow Nation.
Right here with your ghost man and demon hunter, Demon Hunter.
Yes, sir. That's me. I'm the one and only. Yeah, here I am.
Yes, you are. You're irreplaceable, sir. Special thanks to our homes, all our sponsors, Stitcher, Smart Radio, Spreaker, the world's listening. How about you? They want to know, Spreaker.com, Planet Paranormal, Geeky Antics Network, Serious Geek, Silly Fun, GeekyAntics.net, and of course, our friends at Attentive Home Healthcare, AttentiveHHC.com, the S-Whale Project, Give Share, Everybody Needs Nathan.
A little love.
The S-Whale Project.org, check them out, guys, and welcome back to our comfortable, recently Christmas decoration-y studio. in second week of November, yeah.
Do you think Halloween came too quick this year and everybody was freaked out by how fast it got here and everybody's jumping into Christmas a little fast?
Everything's too fast right now. What's wrong with these people, Nathan?
I don't know.
The world's coming to an end.
I was getting upset when I was going into the store to pick up Halloween stuff and the Christmas stuff was already up in the same aisle as the Halloween stuff.
Of course. Hey, Nathan, special heartfelt warm regards to our next president, Mr. Donald J. Trump. We wish you all the best, sir. It's not off to a good start.
Not off to a good start at all. And of course, now we're going to have people trying to burn down the G&D studios. So.
Hey, man, I'm an American, and I read something about it. If you don't want the president of the United States, regardless of who's there, if you don't want them to succeed, you're an idiot.
Yeah.
That's like having the captain of your airplane be terrible and have a terrible time. We all crash and burn.
There are a lot of people, you know, it's tough because a lot of people really saw a direction that they wanted the country to go into for the last 8 years. Mm. And a lot of people looked at it and said, we don't want that direction. And in the end, votes were cast. And, you know, believe it or not, folks, there's a reason for the Electoral College. All my friends who've been saying to me for years, we need to get rid of the Electoral College. Mm-hmm. That would lead to a civil war. If anything was going to lead to another civil war,
right?
The taking down of the Electoral College would be it. But, you know, that's what the election is there for, so that people of another idea can have their shot as well.
That's right.
And like it or not, folks, we're focused on another shot now.
Another
shot. Political as I'm going to get on the show.
We're shipping it out a whole new door, baby. And special thanks to, you know, like him or not, President Obama and his family. Thanks for your years of service. Absolutely.
Indeed. And, our great nation. You know, it's one of those things, again, I wish people would stop putting the hate-ridden posts up on Facebook, Sean.
Ridden. I know. And I tried to stay out of it, but they got me. They got me once.
I loved a nasty election. A lot of people were really hurt by this election. I like an election that's filled with nastiness just because it makes for great radio.
It does.
And when we're not on the radio, we're listening to radio. So
it's always something to talk about.
It really does. It gives us something to talk about on the radio. Yeah. And it's horrible for the nation, but it's great for radio. Look at Jimmy Fallon. He's had more fun with this election than anybody could.
But, yeah, and those guys love it too, man. SNL, oh, yeah. All that. They're crazy if they don't get a controversial. They've made fun of Obama, Bush, everybody. But, you know, it's a weird time in our country. And, you know, the only reason we're talking about it on the show, guys, is because, believe it or not, we are current events also. And yeah. I tell you what, we cover the strange and unusual. And if you don't think this election has been strange, then you're insane.
And I will say this, even though both Sean and I did predict Trump to win, because remember a few weeks ago we were talking about it, Sean.
Yeah, absolutely.
He won by more than I thought he would. I predicted he would win by between 279 and 284. Mm-hmm. And I think the final count is actually 290.
Yeah.
So.
Well, the one thing I can't stand is the, you know, liberals, leftists, that's fine, guys. We're all Americans. But when you take to the streets, all I hear is, Daddy, I want a pony.
Hey, Daddy, I want an Oompa Loompa.
I want an Oompa Loompa.
I want you to get me an Oompa Loompa
right now.
Right.
I played that bumper, Nate, in case you
I hear that, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not going to come down on anybody. I posted on my Facebook and said what saddens me most about this election is seeing so many people hurt over it.
Yeah.
You know, it's supposed to be the most wonderful thing about America.
Yeah.
Is that every 4 years we get to revolt.
Yeah.
And we get a chance to throw the current party and the current power out
and shake it up.
And you don't have to go out to the streets and revolt, and you don't have to burn down people, and you don't have to chop off your leaders' heads after you eat the cake.
Let them eat cake.
Yeah. That's part of the beauty of America.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are hurt. And for everybody out there who's feeling hurt, I'm really sad that you're hurt. And I really wish there was something we could say or do here to make it better. But we can't.
Yeah.
Because it's something you've got to work through. So we're just going to keep on going on and having a good time here on the Ghostman and Demon Hunter show with the Shadow Nation.
Well, Nathan, I can say one thing to the people that's out there and they're very hurt right now is welcome to the real world. And on that note, Tonight's guest is an author, investigator, and artist. She's the author of 17 books on the strange creatures and phenomena. She's a frequent guest on Monster Quest, Monsters and Mysteries in America, and of course, Sean Hannity, and much, much more national TV and radio. Her books include Monsters Among Us, American Monsters, and tonight, we go head-to-head with Miss Linda Godfrey and ask the question, are we alone? Do packs of werewolves roam the countryside right here on the Mystifying Oracle Radio, your Shadow Nation? Yeah. Tonight's guest, Nathan. Very exciting. Very exciting. Did you like that? Did you like that?
I like that. I like that. That's cool.
Thank you.
That's good.
Yeah, Linda is, she's hot, man. She's happening with this werewolf thing. We got to get a hold on it. You know, we're griping about elections and everything else. Ladies and gentlemen, they're very
werewolf
well.
Apocalypse on
yes.
our tails right here.
Not only clowns. Wonder if the clowns were actually werewolves.
Trying to hide the fact that they were werewolves?
Yeah, trying to take the eye off.
Were clowns?
Yeah. Were clowns.
What if they weren't really clowns, Sean? What if they were clowns? They'd been bitten by a clown, and now they turn into clowns when the moon is full. Did anybody check to see if all those clown sightings might have been on full moons?
I don't know. There's something going on with the supermoon coming up, man. Have you read about
tonight,
this?
Tonight is the supermoon.
Is it really?
You got when the show's over, between listening to the Ghostman and Demon Hunter and watching The Walking Dead tonight, folks, go outside and take a look up at the supermoon and make a wish. It's a wishing moon, so.
Oh, well, I did go outside. I went to the gas station moments before I had to run in here to studio, and I was looking up at it. I was looking up at it, and I tell you, it wasn't that amazing. Is it that early? Is it too early right now?
I think it's too early for it, and there have been years where I've gone out and checked out the supermoon, and it looked like it was going to crash into the to this horizon, you know, and other years it hasn't looked that cool, but
yeah, well, you're right.
What are you gonna do
tonight?
Tonight
is a record-breaking supermoon, they say, guys, the biggest in 68 years.
Really?
That's what they're saying. This will be an amazing spectacle tonight as the first supermoon in almost 70 years appears in the night sky. In fact, if you're younger than 68, Nathan, you're right there. You have never witnessed this record. You're feeling like 68 since you fall off ladders and everything.
You bastard.
Yeah, I know. I'm terrible. You never witnessed this record-breaking supermoon in your life, Nate, if you're younger than 68 years old. Tomorrow morning, November 14th, the moon will be the closest it has been to the Earth since 1948. It will appear 14% bigger and 30% brighter. Yeah.
Mm. I just remember a supermoon from when I was a kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I was out driving with the family. And as we were driving down the road, we looked up. It was probably around 2 in the morning. We were coming back from some kind of goat show or something, I guess. And I looked up.
Now, wait a minute. What's a goat show? You're going to have to tell our listeners. Not everybody knows a goat show.
Well, let me finish this part. And I looked up, and there was the supermoon. And I swear I thought that the moon was crashing into the planet.
Oh,
it was that big, and I was scared. It was so big. But a goat show. I was a 4-H kid. Anybody who's from the country knows what that's about. You know, 4-H's, your head, your hands, your heart, your health. I belong to the 4-H Capricians, which is the goat club. We would raise goats. And I would travel all over the tri-state area showing my goats to try and win ribbons and cash prizes.
That sounds dirty, man. Showing
it,
your
goat. It does, doesn't it?
Anyway, Nate, hey, if you missed that tonight, Nate, by the way, I know you're wondering. I can feel it in your voice after all these years of broadcasting together. I can just know when you need to know something. So if you miss it tonight, guys, November 25th of 2034 will be your next opportunity to see this supermoon. There you go. Yeah. 2034, Nathan.
So you'll only have to wait some odd 20 years or so.
That's not that bad.
Yeah.
It could be worse.
Yeah, much. Yeah.
Didn't we have some other supermoon this year? I mean, wasn't it?
Oh, you know what? We had something with the moon. It was, and there was a lunar eclipse this year. And maybe that's why the whole world is topsy-turvy, Sean. The moon's just out of control.
I mean, is it just a coincidence? Oh, we didn't even plan this, folks. That tonight's supermoon coincides with, of course, researcher, author Linda Godfrey talking about werewolves tonight.
Well, you know, maybe that's why we're in so much trouble right now, Sean. It's
that's true. This is
maybe
true.
That's why my brain has been off kilter and I fell off ladders this week.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Tell us about that. You didn't break nothing, though.
I didn't break anything. No. I did wind up. Basically, what happened was I was working in a house trying to find a problem in a house, and I was standing up on a ladder, and I tried to step down, and the ladder slipped out from underneath me.
Right.
And I fell probably about 4 or 5 feet onto a concrete floor.
Right.
And didn't hit my head, but, you know, messed myself up bad enough. I finished my day's work. And the next morning, I thought my alarm went off, and I went to reach to shut off the alarm.
Mm-hmm.
And my left arm wouldn't move.
That's bad.
And I was like, well, this is bad. So I called the office and told them. And I went to the healthcare clinic. And they took one look at it and said, we got to send you in for x-rays.
Oh, man.
And I was like, no, trust me. I fell on some concrete. It's probably just a sprain. At worst, it's a rotator cuff pull.
Right.
I need a sling. I need some ice. And I need some anti-inflammatories.
Nurse, stat.
And yeah. And they said, nope, you have to have x-rays. So they sent me to the emergency room where I sat in the waiting room for 2 hours. Some emergency.
Yeah.
And then they finally brought me in. And took all my information 3 times.
Oh.
And then while I waited for another hour for them to take me in and have the x-rays.
Mm-hmm.
Then they put me back in the room I was waiting in for another hour while I waited for the results. And finally they came in and said, we think you have a sprain to your shoulder with maybe a pull of the rotator cuff.
Right.
You're going to need a sling, some ice, and some anti-inflammatories. I went, gee, thanks. I would have never guessed that.
Yeah, I should have been a doctor.
Yeah. And then they sent me home with a sling, some ice, and some anti-inflammatories. And I spent this weekend, you know, relaxing with ice on my shoulder. And now I have to go in on work on Monday morning and explain why I fell off a ladder. And, you know, because there's always an investigation.
Well, of course. Yeah, they want to know why you were peeping Tom in the girl's window. That's how you fell off your ladder. Don't lie. Anyway, hey, Nathan.
No, when I use that ladder, that ladder is farther away, it's quiet. I got nice binoculars.
Yeah. Hey, anyway, guys. Tonight, we're going to play this little game, Nathan, before we go into the news and all that. Since in honor of our guest, Linda Godfrey, talking about werewolves and everything tonight, right?
I'm there.
This test, guys, are you a werewolf?
Okay.
This is the real deal. It says, once and for all, find out if you're truly a werewolf, Nathan. So answer truthfully. Are you ready, sir?
I am ready.
Question 1. What is your food of choice? Is it medium rare Salisbury steak, the heart of a small child or baby, McDonald's or other hamburger place, soup, non-meat, and salad?
Probably the steak.
The steak, you say?
Yes.
Okay, Salisbury steak. I never liked Salisbury steak. Anyway, okay, question 2. What is your favorite werewolf movie? The Howling, An American Werewolf in London, I Don't Like Horror Movies, or An American Werewolf in Paris?
The Howling.
I would have to agree, sir. But I tell you what, American Werewolf in London comes second.
That's a close second. I love it, and we've had the stars of it here on the show, but The Howling's just something special.
What's your favorite thing to do when you're at home? Sit and watch TV? Isn't the full moon supposed to make people crazy so I'm not safe at home? So I lock the doors, feast on death and destruction in my werewolf costume, run peacefully in the woods catching a rabbit. Well, I guess when you're out relaxing. What's your favorite thing to do when you're relaxing? Sit and watch TV. Lock your doors because it's full moon. Feast on death and destruction, or run peacefully in the woods catching a rabbit.
Well, that's a tough one, because nowadays, since I'm injured, I sit and watch TV. But normally it would be the chase down the rabbit thing.
Okay, so run peacefully in the woods catching a rabbit along the way, right?
Yep.
Okay, so we got that one. Question four. Here we go. Waking up one morning, you discover your sheets covered in something. What is it? Dried blood, cookie crumbs, dirt, or salad leaves?
Probably dirt. I have a pretty dirty job.
Dirt. Okay. Well, you're supposed to take showers before you go to bed, you pig. You swine. Question five. Have you ever growled at someone you didn't like? Yes, but they really bothered me? No, that would be crazy. I don't growl. That would be giving too much warning before I bite them. Or only when they tried to take away my snacks?
No, I'd say yes. I've growled at people.
Okay, yes it is. What is the technical name for a werewolf? Is it Canis Lupus? The ugly beast thing? Lycanthrope? Who cares? I just want to kill people.
Lycanthrope.
I think so too. What is the technical name for a mental werewolf? Oh, Theranthrope. There are mental werewolves? Question mark. Screw mental. I am all physical. Okay, this test is dumb, and I'm going to get a salad. I think so. That's an easy.
I go with A.
Theranthrope. Okay. I think that's how you pronounce it. Theranthrope. Yeah. T-H-I-E-R.
Theranthrope.
Theranthrope. Do you like nature? What? Question mark. I can't hear you. I'm getting a salad. Yes, nature should be protected and loved. Is that stuff I see on the Discovery Channel? Question mark. I don't care. I just rush through it to catch my prey, a small human child. Like,
yeah, I take out the small human child, and I just rush through it for my prey.
Okay, well, I guess should we go with the small human child one then?
I guess I said.
All right, I don't care. I just rush through it, catch my prey. Okay, well, what do you think of werewolves? They're cool to watch on TV. They have nothing to do with salads. They are my brethren. I would not kill them.
Well, I wouldn't kill a werewolf.
Cool on TV. They're nothing.
They're cool. Why would you kill a werewolf?
They have nothing to do with salads. They are my brethren, or I would not kill them. I don't know.
They're our brethren.
Okay. They're our
brethren. They're werewolves. Man wolves. They're part man. You can't just go around killing them.
A werewolf. Do you think you would make a good werewolf? This is the last one. Do you think you'd make a good werewolf? Question mark. Yes, I love nature and respect the natural law. Yes, I'm really good at killing things. No, I'll stick to my salad. No, I would get killed too much.
Well, first of all, my job is killing things, so...
This is true. This is true.
So I'd have to go with yes. I'm really good at killing things.
That's it. Okay, let's score you, sir. Let's check it out right now. And the answer's in. The world is waiting. The Shadow Nation, waiting, waiting. Okay, you ready?
I'm ready.
You got 92 points, sir. Okay. It says, okay, you are a psycho. You should not be allowed out of your cell with padded walls anytime soon. There you go. You are a werewolf,
well,
sir.
Let's cut a few points off of there for the fact that I wouldn't chase down the child. I said that.
Okay, so we'll make that 85?
Yeah, 85. We'll make it an 85.
We can do 85. I think that means you're still crazy. We'd have to retake the test. I don't know. How am I supposed to know these things? Anyway, guys, Nathan has, or is, he either has werewolf tendencies. I didn't take it.
Well, I'm not gonna chase. Answered the questions right along with me. What would your score have been?
The kid, chasing the kid thing would have been different. So I would think 80, maybe? 80?
Not so you're not crazy?
Not as crazy as you, no.
Okay.
Well, you are a member of the secret society.
Well, we are not a secret society because we tell people we're a secret society. Therefore, we are not secret.
Anyway, guys, G&D show. Are you a werewolf? We should probably start doing that each week. That'd get boring fast, though, wouldn't it? Once we figure out we're not werewolves. Anyway, since we're in the news, Nate, you want to go ahead and do it.
Sure, Sean. Apparently Facebook temporarily killed off a lot of its users.
They killed them?
Yep. And I happen to know this is true because one of my friends contacted me and said, I'm not dead. there's no worse way to find out that you're dead than through Facebook.
Oh.
Numbers of... This comes to us from the Huffington Post, Sean.
Okay.
Numbers of users of the site found their personal pages had been apparently been memorialized. Have a drink. Oh, folks, remember, Sean and I are playing the G&D drinking game here tonight. Every time he and I make a mistake, you take a drink. We don't read the news first, so we make a lot of mistakes. So if you're doing anything important this evening, please listen responsibly. So number of users of the site found out that their personal pages had apparently been memorialized, a designation normally reserved for the deceased, around 3:45 p.m. on Friday.
Okay.
Minutes later, however, it appeared that many of the pages were back to normal. Some users never even realized they had been sent to the grave and back. While it is possible the election tore open some hole in the space-time continuum, resulting in people witnessing and deleting their results of their own death, Politico reporter Hans Gold...
That's classic.
Tweeted that the site had referred to the issue as a bug.
Yeah.
Facebook told the Huffington Post what had happened was a terrible error. For a brief period of time, a message meant to for the memorialized profile was mistakenly posted on other accounts.
Okay.
Some spokesman said that the emailed statement. Have a drink, folks. The spokesman said an emailed statement, this was a terrible error that has now been fixed. We are sorry that this happened, and we will work quickly to fix it as soon as possible. This article has been updated with comments from Facebook.
Okay. So they're going to fix
it. Yeah, I actually did have friends, Sean, emailing me going with Photoshop pictures of their page,
mm-hmm.
going, what a way to find out I died.
<Two-faced>. apparently the afterlife has Facebook.
Apparently.
But does it have Twitter? That's the question.
Well, no, they're all afraid of Donald Trump.
No one knows. God took Donald Trump's cell phone away, his Twitter account. Nathan, this comes from our friends at the Mirror, so you know it's a credible story. Anyway, woman claims possessed salad dressing caused $2,000 worth of damage to her home.
Actually, that's 2,000 pounds.
Oh, yeah, I seen that little squirrely sign in front there. Yeah. 2,000 pounds worth of damage to her home. All right. Well, Devel McClen, everybody, says that the food product... Well, drink up just in case I messed up her name. she said that the food product attacked her after she opened the fridge. Yeah. A woman claims to have been attacked by her salad dressing. Devel McClain.
There is no salad dressing. There is only Zool.
There is only fat-free ranch. You didn't get that? I was trying to be funny.
I got it.
All right. Well, you didn't laugh, so you hurt my feelings.
No, I tried. It just wasn't that funny.
So now I shall riot in the streets. Anyway, you hurt my feelings. Devel McClain was hoping to rustle up some dinner when the bottle, which she says was possessed, exploded. The bottle exploded on her, guys. She heard a, and this is her quote, she heard a pop, pop, pop. She looked up. It was possessed. It was going crazy. It was shooting up in the air to the side, McClain told Fox 19. It sounded like a firecracker going off in the house real loud. McClain from Wyoming in the U.S. How could it be 2000? Oh, McClain from Wyoming in U.S. said that the Dorothy Lynch brand salad dressing attacked her when she opened the fridge. Dorothy Lynch brand, guys. Remember this. Dorothy Lynch brand salad dressing. Don't buy it. It's demonic. It's doing spirit cooking. Get it?
It's the devil.
Yeah. Did you get it, though?
Mama says it's the devil.
I said spirit cooking with the salad dressing. Food, cooking. Wow, I'm throwing them out there, guys. Make sure you're in chat. Tell me how funny and clever I am, guys. Anyway.
He needs support.
She says that it's hard to explain. I was attacked by the bottle of salad dressing, McClain told the local TV station. Probably thought I was on the whiskey or something. That's what she was on the whiskey.
She thought she was on the whiskey.
Mm. This is how many people think having a swift pint at lunch is unacceptable. McLean added that she snapped photographs of the scene of devastation, which she did. I'm looking at him. Afterwards, reports suggest that the property carpet, computer walls, and dress were damaged in this incident. And you clearly, guys, in the picture, you see the salad dressing bubbling over from, you know, the bottle. It looks kind of chunky, like there was something in it. Oh. The American estimates that they're approximately...
Was it French dressing?
Viva la France. We come for your daughter, Chuck. Or $2,500 U.S. of damage was caused to the home. She later found out that... How in the heck does $2,500 come out of some food and walls being stained by salad dressing?
She has really expensive wallpaper.
I guess. It's called a wet rag, lady. Just wipe it off. She later found out that the salad dressing had been recalled by the manufacturer. Oh, here we go. Apparently, bacteria in the product causes the liquid to bubble and spew out uncontrollably. Ah. From just $3 a bottle of dressing, from the depths of my toes to the top of my head, I will never eat Dorothy Lynch again. That stuff is crazy, Miss McLean concluded. So there you go. Shadow Nation, don't buy. Whatever you do, don't buy Dorothy Lynch. That's what they say. We don't say that.
We don't say that
that's
at
what
all.
That's what the story
we says. We do say that bacteria is a devil.
That's right. But if Dorothy Lynch would like to sponsor the Shadow Nation, we wholeheartedly support you, Dorothy Lynch Salad Dressing. That's Dorothy Lynch Salad Dressing for all your salad dressing needs.
Hey, Sean, UPI tells us that that eBay has removed a Swedish man's offer of marriage for Americans fleeing Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Stockholm, Sweden, a Swedish man posted an eBay listing offering to marry Americans seeking to move out of the country after Donald Trump was elected president. Gostvik Hallin, 30, listed his auction with a starting price of $50,000 for Swedish citizenship, including marriage, before his post was taken down, according to CNN. The U.S. just became the land of the free to leave. Mm-hmm. Why not move to a better place like Sweden? Yeah. Helen's post read. Often open, have a drink, for all suggestions, females, males, and others, like long walks and Netflix and chill. So,
where's this guy at? Did you say? Is it Canada?
He's Sweden.
Sweden.
Sweden. Oh. Stockholm.
Nah.
Holland told the local, he created the listing as a joke response to the U.S. presidential election on Facebook. So, anyway,
that's a way to get you some cool American wives.
I would. If he's Mormon, he could get a whole bunch of them.
You know, it's funny because everybody, you know, how they were all saying we're leaving and going to Canada, and everybody's saying they're not now. It's funny because Canada released a statement about their immigration laws. And it just so happens that the land, the great place of Canada, has stronger immigration laws than we ever had or ever will have. So good luck with that.
I have friends who originally, they immigrated from Europe.
Yeah.
They immigrated to Canada because years ago there was a much easier process to become a Canadian citizen than there was a U.S. citizen.
Right.
And that's totally reversed now. It's much harder to become a Canadian citizen than it is to become a U.S. citizen. So, you know, things change. It's personally, I want to move to Australia. I want my own kangaroo.
Good day, mate. Well, you remember I went on that show. I got the invite that one time, and they tried to call every name in the book. I mean, 3A or whatever it was. And they tried to say, oh, you liked this person in the election. You're this and that and whatever. And I fought them right back. You know, everybody has an opinion on this stuff, but Australia hurt my feelings. So once again, I feel I'm going to riot, Nathan. Anyway, real quick, because we're at 7:31, my friend.
Oh,
real
my.
Quick. Yeah, well. Oh, my, indeed, my friend. But it's that time of the week where each week we talk about that show. We know.
We love.
Oh, there it is. A little delay on the music. You hear the music. Anyway, the show we know we love right now, tonight, on a Shadow Nation original, Rot Talk.
Rot Talk, Rot Talk.
So, Nathan, last week it's getting good. Of course, we didn't have a show last week, so I wanted to tell everybody how right I was. Nathan and I had
a
bet.
We did have a show specifically so you wouldn't have that chance to tell people that.
That's right. Nathan and I had a bet on what would happen the last week's episode. Nathan said, well, I think they're going to carry over with Negan and da 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 da. And, of course, everybody knows they didn't. What had happened is that they, well,
it was
I'm
a
sorry.
Totally Carol and Morgan episode.
The second
you
episode.
You were right and last... I was wrong. There, you win.
I know. That's on tape, buddy. That's going down in the archives forever. But anyway, this week, guys, I think it's going to switch back if they follow the pattern here. It's going to switch back to, well, last week was Daryl in the...
Last week was Daryl. The week before that was Carol.
Yeah.
And that would make this week would go back to...
Don't say it.
The survivors in back in Alexandria.
Don't say it, my friend, because in the previews, I got a sneak peek at the previews everybody did all over the world where they see commercials. It shows Rick saying, you know, I don't know how to put this to you guys, but I'm no longer in charge. Negan is.
That would be the survivors. So
is that the survivors?
Yeah. Well, Rick's group is the survivors.
Who's King Ezekiel's?
They're the kingdom.
The kingdom. Okay.
So Rick is the survivors. Negan is the saviors.
Yeah.
And Ezekiel is the kingdom.
Okay.
And then Jesus is the hilltop.
All right. The Jesus.
So
nobody
the
messes with
Jesus's Jesus' group.
Nobody messes with the Jesus, man.
Nobody messes with the Jesus.
Anyway, Nathan, we gotta go to break. We're about 3 minutes over. But guys, before we go, on tonight's guest. She's an author, investigator, and artist. She's also the author of 17 books on the strange creatures and the phenomena of the werewolf. She's a frequent guest on Monster Quest, Monsters and Mysteries, and Sean Hannity, and a lot of national TV shows and radio. Her books include Monsters Among Us and American Monsters Tonight. Miss Linda Godfrey, right here in studio on the Shadow Nation. We ask the big question, what's out there in those woods? Yeah, it's the werewolf. We'll find out tonight. Yes. No more zombies.
Are there werewolf zombies, do you think?
Oh, my God. That would be spooky, though, wouldn't it? You could never kill them.
See, those I would want to kill.
Yeah.
Werewolf zombies? Werewolf zombies. I would kill them.
They eat brains. Anyway, guys, on this show, we support the little man. We each week, we play an independent band, one we know, we love. We support the little man, right, Nathan?
Yes, we do.
This week's band is called Forget the Well. That's right. Right off their record, What I Tell My... Oh, I can't say record anymore, right? Can I say
the
album?
The album is...
You still say album?
Track. It's a track now.
Straight from their track, What I Tell Myself. Name of the song, Suburban Outlaw, Demon Hunter.
GhostMan.
Shadow Nation. You know. We'll be right back.
Oh, it sounds a little different. Hey, Shadow Nation, this is Tyler Main, Michael Myers from Rob Zombie's Halloween. You're listening to the Ghost Man and the Demon Hunter.
Hey, welcome back, Shadow Nation listeners around the world. Tonight's guest, she is an American author, investigator, and an artist. She's the author of 17 books on strange creatures and phenomena. She's a frequent guest on Monster Quest, Monsters and Mysteries, and of course, Sean Hannity, and many more national TV and radio spots. Her books include Monsters Among Us, American Monsters, and much, much more. Shadow Nation, help us welcome to the studio, Miss Linda Godfrey. Linda, what's up, my friend?
Hello. Well, the moon is up, right?
Yeah.
So if you're out viewing monsters tonight, you got a great way to look at them.
I know. We got you on for the super moon spectacular. I can't believe it. You know, you've done so much, and not only are you an author, you're a researcher, and you started out. And I'm going to let you tell the story. How did you get involved with the Wolfman and the Dogman and stuff like that?
Well, I had just started out as a reporter at a southern Wisconsin newspaper, and I got a tip that people around my hometown of Elkhorn were saying that they were seeing something out on this little country road just outside of town named Bray Road that looked like a werewolf. They were calling the animal control officer and saying, I don't know what this is, but if there was such a thing as werewolf, this is what it looked like. And I went to see the county animal control officer, and sure enough, he had a file folder marked werewolf.
Wow.
So that makes, when you've got a county official with a file folder marked werewolf, and it's filled with serious reports and complaints of such a thing, that's pretty much news. So I went and interviewed these people. We ran the story, and it went national in like 2 weeks, and this was back in late 91, early 92, before the internet was very much in use at all.
Right.
And it just struck me when I went and talked to all these people in person that they were very diverse. They were racially diverse. There were men, women, blue collar, white collar, you name it. It was farmers. It was a wide variety of people. Yeah. None of them seemed like they were lying or like they were having delusions or were on alcohol or drugs or anything. Many were reluctant to talk about it. They didn't want people, you know, accusing them of being crazy or whatever. Yeah, so it seemed to me that there was some real thing there. And then the clincher was that as soon as the news really got out, went out on AP, Inside Edition came and Sci-Fi's New In Search Of, I started getting letters from people all around the country and even other countries saying, you know, this isn't just something on your little farm road in Elkhorn, it's here too, you know, or I saw it, and I started realizing this was a national and really an international phenomenon. It had been going on for a while, and that what I discovered in Elkhorn was just really the very, very tip of the iceberg.
Right. And now, of course, you worked for the Walworth County. Did I say that right? Walworth?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Walworth County Weekly, Week newspaper. Week. Yeah, you were a reporter. And a lot of people didn't know that. They didn't know you were a reporter. And you got, it's like real life X-Files, Linda. You got the call. It is. It's so cool. Yeah. You got the call out there. They said, Linda, you got to go out here and cover this. The people say they've seen this thing. And some of them reported as 4 foot tall. I'm sorry, 4 foot with on all fours and 7 foot tall standing. And they had also mentioned that it's intelligent. Why is that? How do they know that it might be intelligent?
Well, you know, it's just mostly a gut feeling that people get when it, for some reason, this is a very uncanny thing, and I learned this is universal too. Janet and Colin Board, authors from the UK, wrote about the very same thing of this phenomenon of these cryptids will stop and look people in the eye as if they want to make eye contact. And people say they get the feeling that it understands that they're human. It's curious in them. It seems to be sending sometime this sort of empathic message that I'm superior to you. I could get you if I wanted, that kind of thing. It's very frightening, almost more frightening than just the fact that this thing with fangs that is 6 or 7 feet tall is standing there looking at them. So it's a feeling that people have. And then also, there have been some cases, for instance, in Maine, I introduced this story in my book, Real Wolf Men, True Encounters in Modern America. There was a couple that were sitting out on their front porch in the dark about 10:30, kind of waiting to see if deer came to the pond on their property. And they suddenly got this bad feeling, turned on the floodlights, and they're flanking them. They were being stalked and flanked, three on one side, two on the other, were five of these seven-foot-tall creatures coming right for them. And this displays, you know, some sort of intelligent behavior on the part of the wolf-like creatures.
Five of these creatures.
Right.
Now,
yeah.
Now Linda, I've got to ask. Sean and I took a test earlier, and I scored very high on the possibility of being a werewolf. And, you know, I am a wildlife control operator, which means I've been bitten pretty much by everything out there. What are my danger levels here? It's
Very low, because I've said from the beginning, I don't believe that what people have been seeing, even though it's very consistent in its looks and appearance, is an actual werewolf in the way we think of them, with all the Hollywood hype characteristics and or the medieval ones either, that have all the traditions and legends with them.
Yeah.
A lot of the legends just come from those early werewolf movies, the parts about being bitten by one will turn you into one, or they're forced to come out on the full moon, all that kind of thing is really pretty much Hollywood. And then there are older legends, such as if you've got hairy palms or a unibrow, those are indications that you're a werewolf. Right. And there's just no evidence, no mention of anything like that from the people who see them. And these contemporary werewolves, moreover, in every case that's been reported, don't hurt people. It's not like some grade B horror movie where there's a movie made with the title of my book that I had nothing to do with, which is pretty much just kind of a slasher movie. How many ways could a werewolf disembowel, right, dismember, right, kill a human? You know, it's not like that at all. They scare people terribly. People are often very afraid and suffer post-traumatic stress disorder, things like that, but they're physically unharmed. Whereas you go back to France in the Middle Ages, and the Beast of Gévaudan killed lots of people, whatever it was, whatever the creature was, you know, well over 100 people.
Right. Now,
they're just,
go ahead, Linda. I'm sorry.
I just was finishing to say they're different creatures.
Now, that blows my mind, because, like you said, especially here in the States, we all know and love these classics. Stephen King's Silver Bullet, The Howling. Oh, you got to. I know you love them. You got to, right? Because you.
Yeah. Well, that's one of my top favorites, Silver Bullet.
Oh, yeah. My God, it's so classic. You know, what if not the way we think of them? What type of cryptid? What are these things?
Well, there are several different explanations, and I think that actually some of them are different from one another entirely. You know, you've got the ones that could be flesh and blood. They don't really do anything supernatural unless you count that uncanny look at you as supernatural. Running on your hind legs is not a supernatural act. Most mammals can do it if they are either motivated or injured so that they have to, or trained by a human is one way too. You can find them all over YouTube. So it's possible. I call this view the indigenous dog man, and that just means something that was already here as a wolf or wolf hybrid that somehow was able to adapt with slightly longer paws and learn to balance so that it could run upright when it served its purpose better. But then there are these other ones that resemble, people will say it reminded me of Anubis, the Egyptian god of the dead, with the tall pointed ears and the sleek black fur.
Right.
And these have very humanoid bodies. The other ones have totally canine bodies. There's nothing human about them. These Anubis-type things will appear in people's bedrooms. They seem to be, you know, phantom-like when they want to be. Big shoulders, and they don't really do anything to people either. Then we've got some that look like cardboard cutout shadows, the shadow wolves. I cover those. There's another type that people feel might be related to the Native American skinwalker concept, mm-hmm. where shamans are trained to be able to use their spirit body or their astral body, whatever you want to call it, to send forth kind of duplicates of themselves, or to sort of disguise themselves in a way to go forth in the appearance of a big wolf of some kind. They're also bear walkers. It's not just wolves. But the skinwalker is a different type. And there are more. You know, I could go on.
Right.
So they may be different things. I don't think there is one explanation that fits all.
Well, you know, Linda, and I think Nathan was talking about this before the show, people are going to say, if these things are everywhere, you know, you see them, some people see them, but where are they hiding? Are they in caves? Are they underground? Are they invisible? And I'm not joking, you know, a lot of the Native American legends believe Sasquatch, things like that, can disappear.
Right, and there have been witnesses who have said the same thing about these things. Now, the ones that are sort of phantom-like, I mean, you can imagine almost anything. For them, it's almost pointless to try because we just don't know. But the ones that seem like they're completely canine, completely flesh and blood, just running around on their hind legs, they actually have the perfect disguise, which is that they can drop down to all fours and run around. And if you see one, you're not going to say, there's a werewolf. You're going to say, oh, there's kind of a big, gnarly-looking wolf or wolf hybrid, or what kind of dog is that? And it's all they have to do to not be perceived as a wolf-like creature, and then they can just go and live anywhere that a natural wolf or wolf pack would go.
Go ahead, Sean.
No, go ahead.
I just wanted to ask, you were talking earlier about the skinwalker type of belief systems in the shamans. I remember years, probably around 2010, I was traveling the country talking to people, and I couldn't get onto a reservation to speak to anyone there, but I had spoken to a lot of the people around the reservation, and they had said that, you know, they believed that there was a separate tribe outside the Navajos that were skinwalkers, and that you, when you saw them, you knew them because they looked human, but they also looked animal-like.
Well, that very well could be. I think that there also are those who are part of the tribe, though, although there's the people who live with them aren't very happy about it, and I think there's some enmity there. I don't want to get too deeply into it. But, you know, the same thing was said about Sasquatch, especially by the our West Coast Pacific tribes, and some of the Algonquian tribes in Canada, too, who spoke about Sasquatch-like beings as just a different type of people. And they didn't get along with them, but they would call them things like forest people or something that denoted that they were actually humans and not some type of strange animal.
Right. Now, one of our friends is the author of Skinwalker and Beyond. And he has been out to Skinwalker Ranch and spent a lot of times. I don't think I'm supposed to say that, am I, Nathan? He was never on the property. No.
He never legally was on the property. No, he was never on the property.
Yeah, never on the property. Sorry, man. But, you know, he swears to this. He's seen these things standing up and roaming these grounds out there. And he says he's made the connection between the Native American peoples and these skinwalkers, if you will. And he's also brought up something that was fascinating. And Ryan's going to come back on in the future and talk about it. And maybe you know something about this witchcraft and these things. He said there's local covens out that way that have a very strong connection with these things. And it seems to be there's something going on. Do you know anything? Have you had any reports with witchcraft and these beings?
I get things like that from time to time. I have people who claim that they know this, and a few people have just written and kind of hinted that that's what they did. So, you know, there's another tradition in Tibet called the tulpa, where somebody trains and is able to project a thought form. So if that is possible, and if the Native American medicine men who go down this other path are able to do it, you know, I don't totally rule out anything. I kind of stop when it gets to methods and that sort of thing. It's not anything I want to dig into or know.
Right.
But I don't rule out that sort of conjured type, for lack of a better word, type of being. And I don't think that those are the same things that people see running alongside the road.
Okay. Okay. Of course, I was talking about our friend, good friend of the show, Ryan Burns, author, Skinwalker and Beyond. But the one of the questions from the chat room right now is our friend Chris Settles. He says to ask you, are they sighted more near paranormal sites?
Often, yes. Yeah. And many times paranormal sites are also very ancient sacred sites. You know, we tend to build our cemeteries on people's ancient cemeteries for some reason or other. So many times these particular spots have a very long history. And I did notice a correlation here in southeastern Wisconsin, which at one time was covered with thousands and thousands of animal-shaped effigy mounds, that some of these certainly shaped mounds were definitely correlated with sightings, flaps of the upright wolf-like creatures.
Right. Now, wonder if these things, Linda, really are sort of traditionally how we think of them. Just bear with me. Wonder if humans, certain packs or covens or whatever, certain members of groups or whatever, can transform into these wolf creatures. Is that even a possibility that's ever crossed your mind? Besides, I know you said Skinwalker, but...
Right. Well, here's the thing. I had always really thought that that was probably not possible, and I still don't think that physically changing all your corpuscles, every muscle, every, you know, growing the teeth longer, you know, changing your atomic and DNA structure in a matter of moments is probably not happening. I think it's, you know, something else that is at work, from either corroborating with an unseen world and unseen helpers to projecting your own astral energy. That I could accept.
Okay.
But I did start getting, when I started collecting these stories for Monsters Among Us, I have several eyewitnessed transformations in this book, which I've never really had the luxury of reporting on before. And these kind of astounded me, and they're kind of the most freak me out type of things in this particular book, Monsters Among Us.
Go ahead, Nate.
You were talking... Oh, I'm sorry, Sean. Go ahead.
No, I was just going to follow up on the transformations.
Go ahead.
Linda, the transformations, can you go into that just a little bit?
Yeah, and the two that I have in there that are the most astounding kind of bear out my idea that it's more an instantaneous appearance than anything else. In one, there was a woman in a small church in Illinois, I think maybe 15 years ago, that transformed, stood up at the end of a service, howled, and then in front of 200 people, although not everybody had the same good look at her, but the family sitting in the front pew across from her mother, father, and two kids are the ones who wrote me about it, transformed almost instantaneously into what appeared to be a tall, gray fur-covered wolf with fangs in the muzzle. And the interesting thing was that in this church, instead of claws and paws, it had hoofs, kind of like goat hoofs is what made them think of it. The man drew a really good sketch for me. They gave me a lot of details that I was able to check out and confirm and verify. I interviewed them face-to-face three times and asked them to sign affidavits for the publisher saying that what they were telling me was true and factual. And these were just salt of the earth, normal middle-aged people. He was a Vietnamese veteran, very religious in their outlook. And they were still, you know, just frightened to think about it, what they saw. It only lasted for a few seconds because it happened that the elders of the church were standing up there, and they kind of piled upon this creature, pushed it down onto a church pew, and then within seconds it had transformed back into the woman. So that those who, everybody heard the scream, but only those who were looking in the right direction and had a good view saw the actual creature itself. And then it was just hushed up. The daily video from the church was somehow lost or disappeared. A lot of the church closed. A lot of the people moved away. Quite a few of the congregation were elderly, this couple said, and, you know, had passed on since it happened. But everything I was able to find corroborated it, and that was a pretty shocking story.
Amazing.
I found it interesting what you were saying earlier about the topa. And I've often wondered, when a new werewolf movie comes out, obviously people are thinking werewolf, and so there's a lot more reports out there. But do you find when people are kind of like focused on the idea of a werewolf, even more sightings come out? And is it because they're seeing werewolves everywhere, or is that energy going out there and creating an energy that's conducive to werewolves?
Well, I haven't really seen that correlation. Most of the people who see these creatures have no prior thoughts about them. I've never had anybody say, yeah, I went and saw every werewolf movie, or I just saw the Stephen King movie, and then, you know, I went out and saw the werewolf, or anything like that. There are associations between these creatures that I'm able to find occasionally, between things like UFOs, anomalous lights. Whenever in this book I found a story that had a good enough date that I could check up on it, I went and looked at the condition of the solar flares, the phase of the moon, looked online for whether there were any Bigfoot or UFO sightings in that area at that time, and I found more than I thought that I would, but surprise, there's almost no correlation with the full moon. The most frequent moon phase was like a three-quarters moon, and I'm sure this, you know, my one book is not a statistically valid test for everybody in all time, but it's an interesting first look at doing such things, and I'm hoping that other people who research these things will also begin doing that too, and then maybe we can get a feel for some of these things and figure out what really is related and what isn't.
See, that's interesting right there, because I was going to bring that up, Linda, with tonight's spectacular supermoon. Do you believe, and I think you just answered that, is there any connection between the powers of the moon and the moon phases? I know you said three-quarters moon has been the most you've found. What do you think that is? What would spark something like that inside these beings?
Sure, it could be as simple as that if it did turn out to be true that there are more sightings during the full moon, it's because it's so brightly lit outside, more people are outside doing things. You know, a lot of people like to sit outside and watch the moon or take a moonlit hike or whatever, and that puts you in a better position to view these things. And also maybe it's better for the creatures being out hunting, that they can see more and, you know, just more is going on.
Now, in the past, Nathan knows this because we've done this interview together. I forget the gentleman's name. It escapes me at this time.
Steve Cook.
Steve Cook. I believe it was Mr. Steve Cook. Came on. Mm-hmm. Was he the writer of the song "The Dog Man"?
Yes.
Okay. So I believe Steve came on. And now you, in 2002, guys, to tell you a little bit about this, and we had some questions from the chat room from Chris again about has there ever been video. And in 2002, of course, it was alleged that the 1970s recording was found that became known as the Gable film. And that in the film shows an attack on the cameraman. We don't know what happened with that. Do we, Linda? What happened to the cameraman? What do we know about that video?
Nothing. We know nothing happened to the cameraman. It was the filmmaker's son. He was in a ghillie suit. I know this for sure. This was totally exposed, and Steve Cook and the filmmaker both confessed on national TV on a Monster Quest show in the fourth season of Monster Quest. I went to Michigan with the crew. I visited the maker of the film who originally created it as kind of a spoof or joke. At the end of the film, he actually stood up and put on these big glasses over his, pulled off his ghillie suit hat. And that part was edited out of the film by Steve Cook, who decided to make it into a more serious-looking thing because he was trying to bring attention back to the Dog Man and sell more of his CDs. He told me that, literally, that was why he did it. And I visited the filmmaker's little cabin in the woods where he lives with his wife and two sons. I saw all of the 70s equipment, his 70s snowmobile, the camera itself, the ghillie suit. He posed first in the ghillie suit and reenacted his charge. Yeah. So I can tell you 100% it was a hoax.
That's what we were...
Steve actually came on our show and told us it was a hoax too, Sean.
Yeah, I know. That's why I was asking Linda, because I thought I had read something, Linda, when you got to talk to him offset, and he had told you something different, but you know how the internet is, so I didn't know. Thought I'd ask.
Well, there was a long period when he was trying to get me and a few other cryptid researchers to verify that, yes, we thought the Gable film was actually the Dog Man. And I had said from the get-go, well, I don't know what it is for sure, but, you know, before they confess, I said, I don't know what it is for sure, but it doesn't even stand up. So why would you think it was the Dog Man? There's no real reason to even believe that.
Yeah. You know, and one of the interesting things Steve had said to us when he came on the show was, you know, admitting that it was, he admitted the original song was a fake. He said what interested him in it was he had written this song totally as an April Fool's joke kind of thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And after he wrote it, all these people started contacting him saying, I've seen that. There's a legend about that. There's all this. And he was fascinated by the fact that just saying that he making up this song with no idea or history or anything to back it up, people were coming up to him and saying that they'd seen it and that there was a true history about it. And that's why he carried on with it.
Right. That's exactly right. It happened in 1987. He did intend it as an April Fool's joke. He took a couple of old logger legends, something he saw in the newspaper, and just plain made up a few of the things that are in it. And then that was not really nationally known. It just remained kind of a local thing. And then in it was New Year's Eve weekend of 91-92 when my story broke, he called me and said, hey, we have the same thing in Michigan. And, you know, we were sort of friends for a while until the hoax thing came out. But yeah, we had stayed in contact, and, you know, I would tell him when I heard Michigan things, or he would let me know. So that's exactly right. And he decided a film hoax would be even better, evidently. But, he was trying for a long time to get me and several other people to endorse this film as being the Dog Man, and none of us ever did it, unfortunately for him.
Right. Now, I tell you what, Linda, we've had the honor, the treat of actually going down to Manchac Swamp in Louisiana, down there on the bayou late at night. And I'll tell you
this. Looking for the Rougarou.
That's right. Anybody that thinks this stuff isn't real, you tell that to these Cajun people living down there on the swamp, because we actually seen, they had, was it charms, signs, something painted on the walls and stuff outside the home to ward these things off. And one of the guys I was talking about said the Lugaroo, what I could understand, because, you know, the Cajun, I couldn't really, he talked so fast. Lugaroo, you know. And
you'll be going out there in that swamp there, you're going to be looking for trouble.
Yeah, trouble, boys. But they believe in it. They grew up on it. They were told about these things. And one guy told me that a Lugaroo is also known as a vampire. Is there a connection with those two things?
Well, there are places where there are connections. In Eastern Europe, like the Czech Republic or Poland or Romania, they often have one word for the werewolf and the vampire, and they are considered sort of two sides of the same coin or the same basic creature. So it's a different belief. I haven't really seen in any of the reports, and mind you, I've been doing this for 25 years and I still got reports. I got two really amazing man-wolf support reports just this weekend that I'm working on, getting ready to post to my blog.
Oh, wow.
And I haven't seen any indication of any connection with anything like a vampire.
Okay. The Strega bloodline. Have you ever heard of that? Am I pronouncing that right? Striga?
Like in Nona Striga or?
Yeah, they talk about the tribes. And of course, it went over to Louisiana, but the Strega tribe, the Lugaroo, sorcerer, vampiric types. That's what I was getting at. That's what they were talking about. Because I looked it up when we got home, and they had made some kind of connection with that. And I was just curious, because I met a guy in New Orleans, and he was right around this old church, the church in the square, the famous church, guys. I forget the name of it. But you know how they have artists, they have fortune tellers, and they all come outside this church. And I had met a gentleman, and he could have been nuts, but he looked me right in the eye, and he said he was, in fact, a werewolf. And, you know, that brings me to my next thing. People that believe they're werewolves. Lycanthropy, right? Lycanthropy?
Yeah, that's, yeah, there's actually a clinically recognized psychosis, wherein and there's some confusion as to whether it's actually lycanthropy or just a different type of psychosis, where people will believe that they're a werewolf and they can look in a mirror and see a werewolf looking back at themselves, but everybody else looking at them will just see a human. Although sometimes they'll sort of contort and, you know, people will say, I saw him, his eyes turned strange, that kind of thing. But they're not really turning into an animal. They're still recognizable as a human. And for instance, there were a few years where there was a man living near Bray Road in kind of a facility, and every once in a while he'd go off his medication and believe he was the Beast of Bray Road, and he'd be jumping on people's cars naked. And they didn't report that there was a wolf or a werewolf trying to jump on my car. So it's a very different thing. Now, there are conditions that hypertrichosis, for instance, which is a really rare medical condition where you're just covered with hair from head to toe. And there's a whole family in Mexico that they got famous as circus performers, and there were quite a few in the family strain that had this. And they're not animal-like either. They're 100% human. They just have too much hair and fur. In fact, to the point where they usually have to go get it cut out of their ears and their noses, or they can't hear and can barely breathe. There's so much of it.
Oh my God.
So that's a different thing. Yeah, so there are, and there's another condition called porphyria, where you just get all these symptoms that make you look very strange. But none of them show a human turning into a wolf.
Yeah.
Well, I'd just like to point out, Sean, I wanted to throw this out since I didn't want to interrupt before. You were talking about St. Louis's Cathedral, Louis Cathedral, in right outside of Jackson Square.
That's right, New Orleans. Sir. Yes. Thank you. Jackson Square. I couldn't think of it for a minute, but
yeah.
I've met
that's like my favorite spot in all of New Orleans.
That's the only place I've met a werewolf or a man claiming to be one ever in the world. So I don't know, Linda. I tell you, what's the closest? What's the creepiest thing? Because you've went out on the trail of these. You've tailed them. You know, what's the creepiest experience you've ever had where you thought, okay, something's out here watching me? Have you ever had anything like that?
Yeah, I've actually had more of those occasions with Sasquatch than with the upright wolf-like creatures, but there was an incident. I was actually in Michigan on a different trip with a History Channel cameraman, and we were filming on a desolate country road, just gravel road, nothing around it but fields and bushes. It was 2 a.m. in the morning, because that was when the witnesses' occurrence had happened, and it was like almost fixing to rain. It was 95 degrees, super humid, so I'm really sure that there weren't any people out there in wolf suits. I could rule that out. And the entire evening we'd been shining a flashlight down one end of the road, and we were seeing yellow eyes in the shrubbery and hearing something moving around, heard something shake itself out like the same sound as a huge wet dog. You know, when your dog's out in the rain and it comes in and shakes all its fur out?
Sure.
That's what we heard. And then all of a sudden, I was watching where the spotlight was. Unfortunately, the cameraman had turned in the other direction, but I saw something run just on the edge of the spotlight so that it caught its spine. The spine was vertical. It was covered with gray fur. And as it speedily crossed the road, it momentarily blotted out a 7-foot-tall reflective stop sign, or some kind of traffic sign. It wasn't a stop sign. It was some other, like, deer crossing or something. And one of the witnesses that was there standing next to me also saw it and got immediately so fearful they insisted we all leave. So that was the end of it. It was getting ready to storm anyway. But yeah, there had been just weird things going on all evening, and it was very, very nerve-wracking to be standing out there, none of us armed or anything, just watching and waiting. And if something had come, we would have had to try and get in the van very quickly.
All right.
Well, you know, it's funny. When I remember, Sean, when you and I were going out to film in the swamps, people were offering us guns to take with us in the camera crew, and everybody was like, no, you're not giving them guns. It's
Yeah. Yeah, I remember that. Well, Linda, I got one last thing. And, you know, I think it's amazing. And, of course, in this line of work, this is what we cover, Nathan and I, week after week, year after year, for 10 years now. And, you know, people like you, I think, are amazing. And you make the world more amazing by uncovering these things out there. And I truly believe that these things exist. Do you believe 100% that there's werewolf-like creatures roam our countrysides?
Oh, yeah, the phenomenon is real. I don't know what they are, for sure. And like I said, they could be different sorts of things. There's no real way to tell. But there is something that looks like an upright wolf or dog appearing in many places to many people, many more than we hear from, for sure. That much I will tell you, because most people just don't want to admit that they saw it, or they don't want to be called crazy. They don't want to have to deal with it, and they never want to see it again. So
I can imagine.
That's what keeps me going. As long as these people are continuing to see these things, I feel there's some real phenomenon that we don't understand. Maybe it's just something our present science cannot yet understand. Maybe it's something spirit-based that is going to remain a mystery. Or maybe we'll figure it out one of these days. I couldn't tell you that. But it's real. The phenomenon is real, whatever it is.
Yeah. Well, with people like you out there, I have no doubt that sooner or later we will figure it out. And I think it's definitely going to be stranger than fiction, right? They say truth is stranger than fiction.
Thank you. I think so, too.
Nathan, do you have anything else for Linda?
Yeah, I wanted to ask a couple things here. Just one, being a Jersey boy, by the way, you know, I know you wrote Weird Michigan and Weird Wisconsin, and Mark, big friends of our show.
Oh, they're great guys.
They're awesome guys. But being a Jersey boy, stories like the New Jersey Devil with, you know, a animal with like hooves and a horse's head and a bat's body and any relationship to the New Jersey Devil or even Old Red Eye, who was the New Jersey Bigfoot with, these werewolf stories?
Well, you know, there's just such a variety of, different types of unknown creatures. My most recent book, American Monsters, was written to show that. You know, I just kind of went through and found the best examples I could, not just of my own reports, but from elsewhere. And the Jersey Devil was one that I included. Why there are so many varieties and why they sometimes seem to be creatures made up of parts of other creatures. Like, for instance, recently I've started getting reports about something people call the dog cat or the Doberman lynx. It seems to look like it's part dog, part cat, which it's genetically should be impossible. So there are just all these different things, lake monsters, you know, the Sasquatch, the Bat Squatch, various types of large birds, things that look like they're some extinct animal that shouldn't be around yet, and people are seeing it nonetheless. It's just a complete worldwide mystery.
I've met a lot of people that swear here in Indiana they've seen the Firebird. I mean, swear. These guys don't believe in paranormal whatsoever, but they said that they've seen a bird that blocked out the sun. I've heard it firsthand.
Yeah, and these sightings are still going on. Yeah, in fact, I started out the American Monsters book with what I think is one of the best great bird sightings I've ever seen, because this man saw it on the ground trying to take off, flying away, and at a distance, he had you know, the whole panorama. And this happened up in northern Wisconsin, not too far from the Mississippi River, to just this nice middle-aged professional man, businessman, successful guy, who was riding a bike in this nice neighborhood resort, and saw this huge bird that was standing at least 2 feet taller than him, and he's like 6'5" in this meadow. And when it turned around and saw him, it began to take off, and it was so big, he said he could see its wings rippling as it tried to catch enough air, you know, to get the lift it needed. Wow. To take off. And it still took it a while. It had to fly down this asphalt road that he had been riding on, and as he watched it, he could see the wingtip stretched at least from one side of the road to the other. And when I went there to interview him at the site, I measured that road as about 22 feet wide. So that was the wingspan this thing had.
Jeez, oh, Pete. Linda, what's coming up for you next, Miss Godfrey? Where can people, our listeners, find out more about you and your amazing books?
Well, the easy, simple answer is just to go to lindagodfrey.com. That is my WordPress blog, so there's no www, just lindagodfrey.com. You can follow me there. You can get my Twitter address. I like to tweet. I hang around at a Facebook page. I actually started 10 years ago called Unknown Creature Spot. You can request to be a member there. And then there's lots at my blog. You can read some stories that aren't in the books, things that people write me. There's lists of my books and lots of other stuff.
That's amazing. Nathan, anything else for Linda?
Nothing else for Linda. Before we close the show tonight, though, Sean, I would like to say one thing to you.
Yes, sir.
Happy anniversary.
Hey, happy anniversary, my friend. 10 years on the air.
10 years since you and this. 10 years ago this weekend, you and I first met.
That is amazing, and everybody knows that the start of the Ghostman Demon Show, where we bring you week after week amazing guests like Linda. Man, it's been a heck of a ride, brother. I'm glad I got to do it with you, and we got to do things like this with Linda, talk to amazing people. And Linda, if you could stay on the line 1 second while we close out this show.
Sure. Happy anniversary and happy supermoon night.
Oh, absolutely. Our anniversary is on the supermoon, Sean. That must be a good sign.
It's got to be a good sign, everybody. Shadow Nation, everybody around the world. Wow. Amazing. LindaGodfrey.com. Check her out. Amazing author, Linda Godfrey. From the haunted back roads of America, everybody, this has been another Shadow Nation exclusive interview. Special thanks to all our homes, all our sponsors, Stitcher Smart Radio, Spreaker, the world's listening. Are you? Check them out, Spreaker.com, Planet Paranormal, and Geeky Antics Network, Serious Geeks, and Silly Fun, GeekyAntics.net, 10 of Home Healthcare, 10 of HHC.com, and the SYL Project. Give, share, everybody needs. Nathan?
A little love.
The SYLProject.org. Check them out. Once again, from the haunted back roads of America, it's been an exclusive Shadow Nation interview with Linda Godfrey. Don't go changing America. You know we won't. Demon Hunter.
Because we love you.
Night, guys.